Hi, my name is Mitch Fennell. I'm a member of the Wildlife Coexistence Lab in the Biodiversity Research Center, as well as in the Faculty of Forestry here at UBC. And today I'm going to talk to you a little bit about how to set up a camera trap. So here we have an example of one of our camera traps. And we've picked our site here. We're just off a trail and about 3 meters back. We've picked a nice tree that's about the size that we can get our straps around to secure the camera, and I'll show you how that's done here. So we first secure the camera with just a webbing strap here, and we make sure it's generally pointed in the direction that we're looking to aim our photos at, but we can fine-tune that a little bit later. The next step we're going to do is insert batteries into the camera, which I've already done today. And after that, we'll put in our SD card, which records all the photos onto it, and turn the camera on. And these cameras that we use are pre-programmed using a computer with the settings all in the SD cards themselves. So we can just conveniently turn them on with the default settings and they're all good to go. So the next thing that I'll do is generally take some measurements of the site, some things that we might use as variables in some of our models. And those will include things like the height of the camera on the tree, as well as the distance from the camera to whatever feature we're pointing at, whether it be a trail, a game trail, a water feature, or some kind of bait to lure animals into the site. So next we'll do a walk test to make sure that we're capturing both big and small animals of interest on the feature that we're pointed at. So to set that up here, we'll put the camera into that mode. It'll begin with this flashing red light that, as it's triggered by either heat or motion or both, it will flash red so we can tell where the camera is going to be picking up animals as they move by through the forest. So in this case, we can see down low here, as well as up higher, like bigger animals, and often in the field we'll imitate different animals as we do that. So in this case, the camera's well set to capture both big and small animals on the trail in front of us. We'll make sure it's tightly secured. We'll turn the camera on, and then the final step is to make sure that we secure the camera with a lock so that nobody can walk off with all of our data before we come back to the camera. So the main limiting factors between how long we can check the cameras and leave them out in the field before returning to them to collect data is the number of photos that can be captured on an SD card, which for a 32 gigabyte card tends to be about 40,000, as well as the number of photos that can be captured with one set of batteries. And that also conveniently tends to be about 40,000. And that's also limited by things like the temperature outside, where if it's colder, the batteries will die a little bit faster. An important thing to note is that if you do see a wildlife research camera out in the forest, perhaps in a provincial park in BC, where we have multiple projects from our lab going on, it's best if you just leave them alone and don't mess with them, as they're finely tuned to point directly where we're hoping to collect our data. And messing with that standardization can complicate our results a little bit. All of our cameras will tend to have a sticker on top with contact details, an email address, as well as the name of UBC and our lab, if you want to get in contact about any more information about the project. There will also be a trailhead poster on most trails where there are cameras that might pick up people. So if there aren't trees like this guy here available for the sites that we're looking to set at, we have a few different options. One of them is bringing something to attach the cameras to ourselves, something like a signpost that we drive into the ground if we're in the high alpine. We've also had some success setting them on large rocks in boulder fields, where if we bring a long enough strap and lock to get around it, we're able to kind of wedge the cameras in there. There are also other options that include things like tripods that you can set them on and anchor to the ground to prevent animals from knocking them over in things like prairies.